Thank you and welcome everyone to the PIMCO Data Importer Deep Dive. The Data Importer allows you to, of course, import data to PIMCore. The big advantage of this tool, however, is that everything can be configured in the user interface, so there's no need for coding at all. Imports can be started immediately or on a schedule. Therefore, you can configure an import to run on a regular basis from an ERP system, for example. You only need to configure a data source and a mapping to start immediately. And in this talk, we will take a closer look on how that is done exactly.
First of all, we need to open the data hub itself, add a new configuration for the data objects importer, specify the unique identifier, just go with Spire here, press the OK button. And after pressing the OK button, we'll get all the settings we need to configure our import. The general tab, there's not much to do, but we can activate or deactivate the import. But it's important to know that this option only affects imports that are run on a schedule. For imports we are going to run manually, this option has no effect. The last thing to do here is to enter description. Just enter Inspire Deep Talk. And that's it for the general tab. Let's move over to the data source tab. Basically, we have two options here, the data source type and the file format. For data source type, we can select one of these options here. Let's take a real quick look, SFTP. We can configure a host, a port, username, password, or a remote path. For HTTP, we can select a schema, HTTPS or HTTP. Basically, if we want to use a secure connection or a basic connection. And of course, a URL. For asset, we can input the path of an existing asset manually, maybe import XLSX, or use the search functionality, or just drag and drop a file from the tree to the field. The upload option allows us to upload the file directly from the local hard drive and import the data from there. The push option enables an endpoint where you can push all the files you want to import to. For our example today, we are going with the asset data source type and drag and drop the Inspire XLSX I prepared earlier to the field. For file formats, we have a set of common options like CSV, where you can select to skip the first row, to change the delimiter, the enclosure, or the escape sign. For JSON, there are currently no subsettings. Or we can select XLSX, where we can choose to skip the first row or to specify a sheet name, because Excel files can have more than one sheet, so it may be necessary to change this setting here. For XML, we can select an XPath expression and a schema. Since we already have selected an XLSX file as a data source, we select the file format XLSX here too. Select to skip the first row since our data contains table headers and we don't want to import the table headers. So we have to skip the first row and start the import at the second row. And we have to change this option as well since I named my sheet Inspire. Then let's go to the next tab. The next tab is the import settings tab. The import settings are divided in two panels. On the left side, we have the import preview, and on the right side, we have the import settings. For the import preview, we can either choose a file or the file from the data source directly, or if the data source contains a lot of data, a lot of records, then we can choose to upload the sample data for preview. The sample data should contain all possible values, but not as many records as the data source itself. For now, we are going with the data source. And as we can see, PIMCore will display us the columns from the XLSX file and the corresponding data in the import preview section. We can use the buttons up here to navigate through the records in the data source. Next, we take a look at the import settings, at the resolver settings. In the resolver tab, you can define how you want to load and update existing data objects, if there are any, how and where you want to create new data, and finally, if you want to publish a new data or new data objects during import. Since our import data or import data source contains product information, we are going to select the product class. And for element loading, we are going to choose one of these settings here. No loading would mean that no data objects will get updated during the import at all. ID would mean we have to select a data source index from our data source, for example, article number, but the data source index has to represent the ID of the data object we want to update. Same goes for path, but we are not selecting the column which contains the ID, but we are selecting the column which contains the path to the data object we want to update. Then we have the attribute setting, and this is the setting we are going to use. We have to select the data source index again. We are going for the article number, as you can see here. And for attribute name, we select article number 2. This means during import, we are trying to read the article number from the XLSX file and are looking for a matching data object. And if there is a matching data object, we will update this data object instead of creating a new data object. Next up is the element creation. We can select a static path here. We can select to create all the elements into a specific folder, like the import folder here. You can just drag and drop it or input it manually, or again, use the search functionality. Or we can select to find a parent. Then we can try to find a parent based on the data in the data source. Here we have to select a find strategy again. If we select ID, then we have to select a parent ID column from the data source, for example. And of course, we can choose to not create any new data objects. Then there will be, of course, no data object created during import. We are going with the static path here and just drag and drop the import folder. Location update. The location update setting specifies if we want to move our data objects from one location to another. We can select no change, then the data objects won't be moved, or we can select again a static path, then all the data objects will be moved to this path during import. Or again, we can select the find parent settings like we did in the element creation section with the find strategy and the data source index. For now, we just leave it at no change. The last section here is the element publishing section. We can select one of the four options. Always publish means that imported objects are getting published always, of course. Attribute based would mean we have to specify a data source index or a column in our XLSX file again, which represents the data if we want to publish the data object or not. We can select no change, publish new, which means that no existing data object will be changed, but new objects objects will be published. Or, of course, the no change unpublish new setting, which means that existing data objects won't be changed, but new data objects will be unpublished. We are selecting attribute based here, since we have a corresponding column in our data source. Next up are the processing settings. Processing settings change the way the data is imported. Normally, you don't need to change these settings and can just skip them, but sometimes this can be really helpful. For example, the first setting specifies if the data will be imported in parallel. That means you get a better performance because more than one data object can be processed at the same time. But it also means that you can't build an object tree, for example. If you want to build a tree or some kind of hierarchy, you must choose the other option, like sequential here. And you have to make sure that the data in your data source is in the correct order so that you import the parent first and after that the children. The next option, if you activate this option, the import file will be saved to the import logs, and you can take a look at the imported file later on after the import. But be aware, depending on the size of your import source, this could easily fill up your storage. Next is the data index of ID field. You can specify an ID field in your import source. This field must contain the unique identifier of your data object. In our example, this would be the article number. And this gives you the possibility to do a delta check. Based on hashes, the import then will try to detect if there are any changes between the data in your import source and the data stored in PIM Core, for example. Then the cleanup not imported elements option. Sometimes it can be handy to clean up existing data objects if they are not needed anymore. Here you have two options: unpublished data object and delete data objects. Every data object that is not included in the import source anymore will be unpublished or deleted. So be really careful with the settings and always provide a full import. Otherwise, this might lead to data loss. We are going to revert the settings now to the default ones for our example. Next would be the mappings section. Here you can either add all the mappings entry manually, or you can select the autofill button. Click on the autofill button. The autofill functionality will try to match every label or every column in your data source to a corresponding field in the data object. For this example, we are going to add some mapping entries manually. Of course, we want to or map the article number since it's our unique identifier. We have to select a source attribute, article number, and then we have to select direct here because we want to fill in the value directly into the article number field. Then we add another one, for example, could add the model. Again, we want to select the model here, type direct again, and field name model. When we take a look at the preview, we can click refresh and see all the columns we have already mapped so far with the green background. Then add another one. Maybe we can add a little bit more interesting column right now. For example, the categories. We want to add categories to our product. Therefore, we select categories as a source attribute. And as we can see in the preview, this column contains more than one value separated by a delimiter. And since we can't import this value directly, we need to make use of the transformation pipeline. I open the section here, click Add, select explode function, choose a delimiter. And as we can already see in the transformation result preview, we already have an array with three entries and the single values in each one of them. But we are not already finished. We want to add another transformation to our pipeline because we want to load objects that are matching with the IDs in our array. Let's click Add. Let's look for the function load data object. And as we can see in the transformation result, we are trying to load the objects corresponding to the ID now. And then we can select the data target type. Now we don't want to add any field directly. We want to add them to a many-to-many relation. Since there's only one relation for our product class, we can select category here and choose if we want to replace the existing relations or merge them with the existing relations. Then we could go on and just add another field and another field. For example, manufacturer and type direct again, field name, manufacturer, for example. The next tab would be the execution tab. We can add a cron definition here, or we can choose to execute the import manually. To execute the import manually, we have to save it first. Then click on the Start button. And as we can see in the execution status section, we have a progress bar and we can cancel the execution and clean up the queue. I'm going to start the import now off screen. As we can see, we get the status of the import. And now all of the records in our Excel file have been processed. At last, we can check the import in the import logs. And as we can see, we have successfully imported our data source. We can check the logs here. We can take a look at the raw data, or we can just click here and open the file directly in PIMPCore. And as we can see, we have the model here, the manufacturer here, the model here, the article number here, and all of our categories we have put through the transformation pipeline. And that's it. Thank you for your attention, and hopefully we see each other again next year.